So welcome once again to all of you. Thank you for joining the session of EI 101 series. Today we have another very interesting topic, learning emotional intelligence through Indian storytelling tradition. And we have a very excellent resource person, Rajesh Kamath. Whatever I say very little about him, I think it will be whatever I say, it will be very little of him, because I don't know how do I put his whole of his profile in front of you. But I would love to introduce as my beloved brother, and as a guru, as a mentor, as a good friend, coach, and very, very enthusiastic and ever smiling person, rich in HR knowledge, rich in consulting, Chanakya Nitis and ancient wisdom. And I think he has a zest for learning for everything. And he's having great interest in everything, I would see that's what it is. And I don't know ever he has had, did you have any time conflict, Rajesh? I never think you'd had. Because I always see you that whenever there's a conflict, you suddenly smile and everything goes away. That's what I would say. Anyway, thank you so much for taking out your time and being there with us in this session. And I would not take much of others' time. I would want that entire time of Rajesh to be talked about on this subject. And let's learn from him. Welcome, Rajesh, to this series. And welcome all of you again. And let's begin the session. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Annapurna. And I feel good that you saved me for the last. Hopefully, it will also be among the best of the lot. But welcome, friends, for EI 101 series. I think it has been so beautifully put together with, of course, the team of Emotion Analytics and especially my sister Annapurna, who has made it possible. So today's session is going to be very, very interesting. For me, it's always interesting to share stories, and especially from Indian wisdom. But of course, what we are going to try and do, especially for those who have been attending the last few days' sessions, is also bring together all your learning in a particular way through the Indian storytelling tradition. Because likely all of you have already figured that everything that's been spoken about today in management across the world actually comes from the same root of Indian tradition. Of course, it's got different forms and got specialized now in different ways. And that's important. And learning continues, in various forms. And that we must. But it's very interesting to see where it all began. Of course, I don't intend to share a historical perspective, but I'll bring to you as much as possible, whatever I can through today's session. One quick check with you, Annapurna. Will you move the screen? Sorry, I forgot to check.
Yes. I will be doing it. You just tell me next when, then I will do that.
So I have put on the screen itself. I know it would have caught everybody's attention. It's a very, very beautiful screen comprising of many Indian scenes. You can see the diversity right in the screen itself. So it's been prepared by one of my very wonderful colleagues, Tejal, who's also attending this. So thanks, Tejal, very much. Yes, let's go to the next screen. Yeah, if you could please move to the next screen, Annapurna. Right. So I'm going to share just a few inputs, which all of you are already aware of. But it's very important to bring this into perspective so that you can connect to our stories much better, right? So what is emotional intelligence? And I don't intend to go into great details of this, because most of us know this, but it will provide for us a great foundation on which to build these stories. So the ability to recognize emotions in self and others is one of the most important things about emotional intelligence. The ability to manage emotions in self and in our relationships, which is probably one of the most important aspects of emotional intelligence. Yesterday, Vijay so nicely covered that it is a cluster of related abilities where ability refers to capacity. I so loved this, that capacity is unrealized potential and potential is energy. So that's extremely important, right? AI becomes more important as we climb up the corporate ladder. I think most of us know this, that there's a lot of research around this, which shows that as we go higher up, and not just in corporate ladder, I mean, you could be in education, you could be in society, you could be in family, but wherever you are in a position of responsibility, emotional intelligence and the measure of it, which is EQ, determines leadership. And that certainly is something that we will touch on the most today, because that's something that's vital to all of us. Yeah. So EQ determines leadership. Yes, let's go to the next screen, please. So let's go straight to a story. And this story is referred to by many names. And some of the names are Yaksha Prashna, Yudhishthir Yaksha Samvad. And many of us would be aware of this story as well. But let's see, for the benefit of those who do not know this story, or even those who know this story, try to look at it from a slightly different perspective now, okay? With fresh ears and fresh eyes, let's listen to this story again. So the term Yudhishthir itself is very significant, but I'll come to that later. You know what this name stands for. And this, as you know, is there in the Aranyaka Parva of our great epic called Mahabharata. Right? To me, Mahabharata is not just an epic, but it conveys what Bharat is, which is a great nation. Okay, and why is it great? Let's see. This is one of the stories that suggests that. So the story goes that a certain situation arises when the brothers were chasing a particular beast in the animal, a deer actually, and they could not finally chase it down, but everyone got tired, and the oldest brother Yudhishthir most of all, he sat in one place and said, I can't go on anymore, I'm tired, I'm exhausted, and my throat is parched. So he requests his younger brother, Nakul, seemingly his favorite, to fetch him water now. Okay, so how does one look for water in a forest? So if you see now, of course, with the lockdown, we are getting back to some of our, nature's blessings. One of the ways of looking for water was to see where the birds circle in the sky, which is generally around a water body, right? So Nakul climbs up a tree, and in the distance, he sees that some birds are circling a particular water body. He knows that's where he has to go. So he proceeds in that direction. And as he proceeds in that direction, he lands up at a very beautiful, large lake with very peaceful water, very placid over there, lying and inviting as well. So, looking at that water, most of all, he is very tempted to go and drink the water, right? So, he bends down, he sits over there next to the lake, and as he sits down over there, and he just about to have a sip of water before he can fetch it for his brother, suddenly, he hears a voice. The voice says that don't drink this water before you answer my question. He cannot make out who it is. He looks all around him, but he cannot see anyone. Suddenly he hears the voice again that says, don't drink this water before you answer my question. He thinks it must be a hallucination. Ignoring the voice, he bends down again to drink the water, and as he touches the water, the life goes out of him. So he lies dead, lifeless, right next to the lake. So waiting for a long time, Yudhishthira has no option but to send his other brother. So this time Sahadeva comes Sahadev comes and he too looking at the water before he can take water back to his brother. He too wants to have a sip of the water. The voice beckons. He does not pay attention to it. He loses his life as well. And so also it happens to both Bhim and Arjun. So all four brothers who went to fetch the water lie lifeless next to the lake. Yudhishthir now knows that something is definitely wrong. He's wondering what could have happened to his brothers, right? Remember that these brothers were extremely powerful in their own way. And therefore, it would have been something serious that had caused it. And that causes him a lot of concern. However, he has no option but to proceed in the direction of the lake, looking for the water, of course, but more importantly, where his brothers were. As he lands up at that lake, he sees the bodies of his four brothers lying lifeless over there. Imagine the sorrow that it would have caused him, right? He is very, very sad to see that. In fact, he's shocked. But interestingly, he looks for some signs of struggle. He sees none. There are no marks whatsoever which could have caused a war, which would have caused a fight. No signs of a struggle, nothing. He keeps looking around and he finally realizes in his mind that it must be a super force, something that is not natural, that is supernatural. And he mutters to himself, saying, what could have happened here? I need to be peaceful. I need to be calm. And then he speaks aloud, thinking of a plan. He speaks aloud and says, what happened to my brothers? Who did this? A voice speaks up. He says, I am the Yaksha of the lake. Okay, Yaksha is a spirit. Of course, it's a different creature in Indian wisdom. Take it now as the spirit of the lake and says that I am the one who did it. I am the Yaksha of the lake. The lake is mine. Your brothers did not listen to me when I called out to them and warned them not to drink the water before they answered my questions. For ignoring me, they got dead. And the same thing will happen to you unless you answer my questions. Yudhishthir immediately does a namaskar to the Yaksha and says, I am here to listen to what you have to say and I shall be happy to answer your questions. And so Yaksha starts asking the questions. So there are 100 questions in this entire sequence. But imagine, he asks the first question and he says, what is the meaning of life? What is happiness? And one by one, the questions follow.
Hello.
Yudhishthir responds to every single question very patiently, to the best of his abilities. He knows that the answer to each question holds the key to the life of his brothers. For every question, imagine you are thirsty, you are hungry, you are tired, you are scared, you are worried, you are anxious, and still you have to answer all these questions. Finally, the 100th question is asked, and at the end of the 100th answer which Yudhishthir gives, I'm not going into the question because that itself will be a couple of sessions. Very interesting. You could read it later. At the end of the 100th answer, the Yaksha is satisfied and it says that you have answered all my questions perfectly well. I am very pleased with you. And because of this, I am going to grant you the life of one of your brothers. And so please choose which brother you want alive and take back home. Mind you now, there are four brothers who are lying dead over there. The choice given...
Sorry, Rajesh, the voice is cracking. Please, can you... 30 seconds, it is cracking in the middle. We missed out.
Okay, I'm right next to my machine. Just give me a moment. Let me try doing something, yeah? Just give me a moment.
Also, please, others, if you can mute also, it will be easy because there are certain
yes.
sounds which are
you
coming.
Please do that.
Please mute.
Yeah, can you hear me now? Is it better?
It is clear. It at okay. times it's cracking, but otherwise, I think it's fine. You continue. We'll see again.
Okay. Okay. All right. So yeah. So sorry. Yeah, it's clear. I'm told. So he's offered the choice of one brother whose life he can get back. He now has to make a choice. I'll go a little slower so that in case you don't hear a couple of words, you can still get the gist of the story. Yeah. He says it will be Nakul. Specifically to EI. Okay. Now Yudhishthir, as the name suggests, it is Sthiratha in Yuddha. Okay. So he showed great Sthiratha even in fear, trepidation, sorrow, tedium, thirst, hunger, anxiety. Number one. He enhanced his sense of observation and listening under very trying conditions. He filled himself with hope and peace. And mind you, the very important part of this story is that all of this was not sudden, as it may seem, but through Vinay. And I will come to this Vinay later, but remember that Vinay is not just Vinamrata. Vinay is trained mind and it comes through constant and consistent discipline. This helped him turn successful. And very importantly, he was a master of meaningful dialogue, right? It's not very, very common to hear great stories about Yudhishthir. Of course, the day before, Shyamaji, our great teacher, covered various characters from our epics. And Yudhishthir was also there. But here is one story that gives us an idea of what emotional intelligence means. Okay, I'm not drawing direct conclusions here, but it gives you an idea. How to develop this, I'm going to share along the way and at the end. Okay? But here are the lessons from our first story.
Rajesh, it is cracking a bit. I think you just see whether you're too close or too far.
Okay. Is this helping?
Yeah, this is fine. This is
so
fine.
I guess whenever I come closer, it is a little better.
Yeah, please. Yeah.
Okay. Next slide, please. So we'll go to our second story now. Okay. And this story is of our favorite character called Tenali Raman. And story, you know, there are lots of stories of Tenali Raman. And this is the story of an unrecognizable prince. It's a very interesting story. Now, Tenali Raman has been wrongly understood, sometimes labeled as a court jester. Very important, friends, I want to tell you that he was not a jester at all. In fact, he was one of the Ashtadigaj of the Vijayanagara King Krishnadev Rai.
Rajesh, sorry to disturb you, but again your voice is cracking.
Okay, it rarely cracks actually. I do my...
Now it's better. It's better.
Yeah. So, I will go slowly so that you can hear. I'm very sorry about this. I have no idea what's causing it. It happened day before as well with Shyamaji. I will go.
No, I think
Off the video, then it will be clear. The voice will be clear. Why don't you try that?
Okay, let me do that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, is it better now? Okay, I hope it is better now.
Yeah. All yes, right. Better.
Yeah. So I was saying, Tenali Ram was one of the 8 scholars in Krishna Dev Rai's darbar. Okay, Ashta Diggaj, as they were called. And Tenali Ram was blessed with great humor, which is why sometimes people tend to call him the court jester. But he was not there for entertainment. He was a great scholar of the Shastras. Okay, now here is an example of a wonderful story and occasion where Tenali Ram proved both his intelligence and his humor. Let's see. Let's listen to the story. So the story is told that once a man with a very imposing personality entered the darbar of Krishna Dev Rai and threw him a challenge. In those days, it was not very uncommon for one king to throw friendly challenges to other kings. So in this case, the man who came was from the kingdom of Vellore. And he said, "We have a challenge for you. Are you ready for it?" "Yes," said Krishna Dev Rai. "Absolutely. What is it?" He snaps his fingers and 5 young boys walk into the darbar. All these boys look identical. Okay. They are same in their height. They are similar in their build. They are similar in their complexion. Only in their facial features, maybe they differed a little bit. All 5 boys walk in, and the man who had brought them says that, "I want you to identify who is the Prince of Vellore." Okay, now this is not an easy challenge because all of them look identical. So, well, the king says that shouldn't be a problem, and he looks at his Ashtadigaj. So one by one, now they have to try and crack this challenge. The first one comes, Ashtadigaj, and he says, "Maharaj, I'm sure that this will be an easy task, because at least one of our Ashtadigaj would have already seen this prince somewhere on some royal occasion. And that should be possible. Such a person will easily recognize." So the man who had come, the handsome man from the kingdom of Vellore, says, "Maharaj, this will not work for you, because I had already confirmed that this prince has not been seen by anyone." Okay, so unfortunately, none of the Ashtadigaj can recognize the Prince of Vellore merely by looking at all of the 5 boys very carefully. The first chance is gone. Another Ashtadigaj comes and he says, "Maharaj, I have an idea. Let's look at the palms of all of these boys. It should be possible to make out from the lines of the hand who has a royal fortune." The handsome man from Vellore who had brought them in immediately protests, and he says, "Maharaj, the challenge was to make out who is the Prince of Vellore by just looking at them, not by examining them in any way." And so the second opportunity is also gone. A third Ashtadigaj comes and says, "Oh Maharaj, this shouldn't be a problem. We just have to speak to each of them one by one, and we will know immediately who is the prince." Once again, the man protests and he says, "No Maharaj, this too is not allowed, because you are only to take a look at the 5 princes and identify who is the prince of valor. So now, well, Ashtad Digaj don't know how else to crack this challenge. And everybody starts looking at who else but Tenali Ram. Tenali Ram immediately says to the Maharaj, Maharaj, what kind of hospitality are we providing? And especially these kids have come from so far. I think we must immediately give them something to eat and drink. Saying so, he rushes towards the kitchen of the palace and he comes back with a packet of laddus. And before anybody knows what's happening, he starts offering the laddus to all the five boys. Four of them accept the laddu. Obviously, they were overcome by hunger. The fifth boy is just standing without any reaction and not taking the laddu. Tenali Ram knows this will be the boy. However, he decides to push this a little further. And therefore, he tells the boy, come on, why don't you go ahead and have a laddu? One laddu won't hurt. The boy has a question mark on his face. He's unable to respond. Immediately, Tenali Ram says, Maharaj, here is the prince of valor. Maharaj asked the man who had brought those five boys, is he right? The man says, yes, he's absolutely right, Maharaj. But I'm very curious to know, how did he figure? Mind you, no communication took place. At least not verbal communication. Tenali Ram immediately says, Maharaj, the prince of valor is not used to being treated like this. For starters, the prince is one who is always giving, right? From his hand, normally clothes, food, jewels, and so on are given to the praja. And here in this case, he was being given a laddu. He didn't know how to face this situation. Just to confirm that he indeed was the prince, I pressed further. Now, mind you, princes are never given food directly. They are always handed to him by a trusted person. And I'm a rank stranger. The moment he was faced with this situation, he didn't know how to respond. And I knew this was the prince. Okay, so that's how the entire challenge was cracked. Let's go to the lesson system. Please also form your own lessons. I hope you have a notepad next to you so that you can constantly put down your own learnings. Think of the character of Tenali Ram. Okay? When everyone seemed very confused and maybe even worried that I hope we do not lose this challenge, Tenali Ram alone was unflappable, as he always was in times of difficulty. He replaces stress with positivity on every occasion. When challenged, he actually gets creative. He's alive to each moment, friends. He shows presence of mind. Think about what he did over here, right? Nobody expected what he did because very smartly he ended up going and getting those laddus when nobody was, you know, even thinking of such a thing. And by offering those laddus, he created an opportunity to identify who would be the prince. So he generates insights through such adversities, through such challenges. Okay. Each of these, as you would have figured, are part of something that we recognize today as emotional intelligence. Next slide, please. So I've given you two very different stories. One which was from Mahabharata, one of the epics, and second which was from Tenali Raman, whom we generally connect with humor and entertainment. Both were positives. Now let's look at a third story, which is going to give you another side to our minds. Okay. Now remember the term man, I'm using this universally as in human. And the term man itself comes from manas. So many terms in English come from Sanskrit words, and manas refers to the mind. So let's look at the mind of the character in this story. A man sets out on a long Tirtha Yatra. And in those days, you generally went for a Tirtha Yatra, you would travel as much on foot as possible. That was the way you put your own body to trial. So as he was walking along, he suddenly felt very tired from the journey, scorched from the heat of the sun, and looking at a tree in the distance. Next slide, please. You will see a very beautiful tree on the slide, which will give you an idea of how inviting it was. He decides to rest under that tree. You can avoid the looking at the lessons right now. Listen to the story. He sits under the tree and then gradually he begins to feel sleepy. So he lies down over there. In the shade, as he's lying down, it comes to his mind, how I wish I had a soft bed under me. It would have been so nice. The moment this thought came to his mind, a bed also appeared. And the bed came under his body. He was lying on the bed. He was very surprised. But this tree was a Kalpataru, right? Or a Kalpavriksha. It means a tree that grants all wishes. Now, remember, this story was in ancient times. So this man continues to think, how I wish I had a young damsel pressing my feet and lulling me to sleep. The moment he thought of this, a beautiful young girl appeared right next to his feet and pressing his feet. And at that moment, he started beginning to feel hungry. And he said, how I wish there was a lot of sumptuous food around me. And suddenly, a large table appeared from nowhere. And on that table was spread out many, many plates with wonderful varieties of food. Yeah, very, very tempting. He had a little bit from all of it and filled himself up. He says, I wish I could get some wine. And the drink and the large jug of wine appears, which the damsel pours out for him. Now, as he has the wine, it begins to take its effect on him. And gradually, he starts thinking about the entire account of the whole day and how various things happen. Suddenly, a thought enters his mind. I hope I'm not in a jungle where a tiger will pounce on me and eat me up. The moment he said it, a lot of trees appeared all around him and a tiger came from nowhere, pounced on him and ate him up. Okay, now this is the story of the human mind, friends. The lessons from this story, he lost his mind, caught up in a deluge of emotions. His positivity, he got the bed, he got the food, he got the drink, slowly turned to negativity. And negativity takes us, can turn out to be very toxic and even lead us to death. So very important is to note is we have a choice. And that choice is what we need to make of our emotions. Next slide, please. Okay. So we come to the fourth story now, and then we will look at all the lessons together and what they mean to us in the context of emotional intelligence. Okay, mind you, we will have the last 10 minutes for your questions. So I'm going to take one story from one of India's favorite set of stories called Panchatantra. In fact, I must say, not just India's, but of the world. Okay, I'm going to take one story from this. This is a story that many of you may recollect. There is a pigeon, or rather a king of pigeons, called Chitragreev. Chitragreev is flying into the forest with his band of pigeons. And suddenly he sees grain spread on the ground somewhere. The moment he looks at it, they all swoop down and he says, come on, let's have these grains. There is a crow who's flying overhead in the forest. His name is Lagupatanaka. Lagupatanaka notices that it is actually a hunter, or rather a trapper, who has set this trap. He can see the trapper in the distance. He knows immediately. And he warns Chitragreev and he tells him, please don't eat. This could be dangerous. You may land into the trap. But his words are ignored. And they all go on because they're hungry and they think, hey, what harm can these grains do to us? They go ahead and start eating the grains. As soon as they had eaten a few grains, the net falls from above and they all are lying helpless in the net. They're all wondering what to do. Chitragreev immediately says to them, I am your leader. I landed you in this difficulty. Now I will ensure that I get you out of it. He immediately thinks of a plan. He says, friends, we cannot get out of this net, but we can certainly do something about it. When I say let's go, all of us should lift the net together and fly with it. Okay? And saying so, he says, let's go. They all follow their king's orders, lift the net and start flying. In the distance, they're wondering now what next. And Chitragreev tells them, don't worry, friends. In the neighboring village is my friend, a mouse called Hiranyaka. I will call out to him. And so he whistles to his friend. And the moment he speaks up and whistles to his friend, Hiranyaka comes out. And to make a long story short, they land over there. Hiranyaka with his band of mice managed to cut the net, the various parts of the net, make holes in it, and the pigeons are now free. Okay, so that's the story, and you would have remembered this story even as kids, especially those who are 30 and above. This used to come in the year 1972 as a very beautiful cartoon, one of our first cartoons on Doordarshan. So here was the fourth story. Yes, the lessons from this story, please, on the next slide. Think about the lessons, make your own notes on this, because this will help you learn much more than what I am sharing over here. Yes, the next slide. Yes, so I'm going to introduce you to the six emotions, okay? These six emotions I want you to remember very carefully, okay? While in Indian wisdom, you would have heard of a term called Shadripu, Chanakya calls them as the Arishad Varga, and they are modified slightly. I am referring directly to the English words here. Yeah. They are lust, anger, greed, pride, arrogance, and foolhardiness. I repeat, lust, anger, greed, pride, arrogance, and foolhardiness. Okay, so here initially greed and then foolhardiness caused them to ignore the warning of the crow. But the leader took ownership of the distress. He converted fear to hope and used hope and creativity to generate enthusiasm and life. Yeah. Next slide, please. So now, all these stories together, let's put some lessons from these stories. Yes, if you could just click them one by one. Okay, they're all there. Now, I want to tell you that in Indian wisdom, there are three S which are very important, which will help us overcome the lack path or Arishad Varga. Okay, the first is Swadhyaya. Swadhyaya, normally called study by self, is also the study of self. Remember, friends, if emotional intelligence is about recognizing emotions in ourselves, and I'm sure the rest of the days would have introduced you to various ways of recognizing emotions in ourselves. It's very important to study self and identify what are those emotions that arise in me so that the next time I can be more aware and gradually move to self-regulation. Now, the second S is Sharanagati. And these are Indian terms, I use them as they are. We have to submit ourselves, choose, find a guru, and submit ourselves to Vriddha Sayog. Now, Vriddha Sayog, Sayog is company. Vriddha is not someone only who is old. A guru needn't always be a very, very elderly 70, 80 year old. Not necessary. It could also be a person who is extremely advanced in his or her knowledge. Okay, the guru can be both male, female, and can be from any discipline. The third is Seva, and Seva is devoted, I should have added that word, devoted service of the people. People can be customers and employees, right? So yes, so I didn't miss that, Vikashji. Yuddha is war, and Sthira is being calm, being present, and being steady. All of that together in a warlike situation, in adversities, is Yudhishthir. So Yudhishthir actually is a term. It's not just a name. It's a very important term that says being calm in the face of distress, being stoic and steady in the face of distress. I hope that helps. So friends, please remember Swadhyaya, Sharanagati, and Seva. Yes, please go to the next slide. I just have two, three more slides and then I will pause for questions. So I want to tell you, friends, that in Indian wisdom, Chanakya has given us 8 steps, which I'm referring to as wisdom continuum, because he has said, you can see the terms over there, Shushrusha, Shravan, Grahan, Dharan, Vigyan, Uha, Apoha, Tattva, Abhinivesha, Prajna, Gunaha. So these are qualities of Prajna. Now Prajna is consisting of many qualities, but I am calling it wisdom for now. The wisdom continuum, okay, all these 8 steps will indeed help us to grow our emotional intelligence. What are they? Hunger for learning is Shushrusha. Deep listening is Shravana. Focus on each of these very carefully. Of course, this deck will be given to you so you can look at it again. Grahan is reflection for better absorption. Dharan is retention of the absorbed concepts. Vigyan over here, or Vijnan if you will, is not science, but it's playing with the concepts that we have just learned. Yeah, you need to do Vijnan after the session is over. Uha is introspection to pick up key ideas. Apoha is rejecting the remaining ideas or pushing them for later, for consideration later. And Tattva Abhinivesha is to firmly focus on the distilled thoughts for application. Okay, these eight together form Prajna Gunaha. Yes, please. Next slide. So I'm done with the slides per se, but I want to share one last image. I'm not going to the story. Just about Vikramaditya, you've seen this image, you know, right from childhood. Very important to know that what does Vikramaditya going to the Smashan Bhumi mean? In emotional intelligence, in fact, Kautilya has an opening invocation where he says, Om Namo Shukra Brihaspati Abhyam. Shukra here refers to emotional side of the mind. And Brihaspati here refers to the intelligence, logical side of the mind. Chanakya urges all leaders, leaders today are the kings of those days, to solve problems using both emotion and intelligence, left brain and right brain, and you know, solve all our problems in the midst of adversities, just the way Vikramaditya was able to do it, even being in a Smashan movie. Okay, so basically the question over there is the last question that was posed by the Vetal, where he said, if you can't solve problems, why would the world need you, O Vikramaditya? So I shall pause here, friends, and we'll take questions. I hope these four stories helped you understand emotional intelligence, the various aspects of it, only by focusing on the lessons in these four Indian stories, very, very Indian stories. Questions, please.